snakes are, well, big. And when it comes to big snakes as pets, there are two that are king of the castle. We're talking about Burmese pythons and reticulated pythons. But what is the best pet for you? Today, we're gonna go over six categories. I'm gonna tell you who the winner of the big snakes really is. My name's Adam. This is Kratos. You're watching Wickens, Wicked Reptiles. Stick around. So both Burmese pythons and reticulated pythons are big, huge pythons from Asia. Places like Thailand, Indonesia, and of course there's overlapping ranges and ranges where there's one but not the other. But either way, they're all from Asia. And of both, there are the mainland varieties. So the mainland reticulated pythons, which are the longest snake in the world. Burmese pythons, which are technically the third longest snake in the world, but usually more heavy bodied. And then there are the dwarf and super dwarf varieties, which are insular, which means that these animals are from islands, which is why they're so small. Generally, when a snake is from an island, it's going to be smaller because there's going to be smaller prey items available, therefore they won't grow to full size. And let's start off with size. And yes, there will be a winner at the end of this one. No ties today. So size, this is obviously a very big snake, and this is a male. That means that this is not even as big as Burmese pythons get, because with both berms and retics, the females will generally get bigger than the males. So this is basically a full-size male. We measured him at around 11.5 feet. I thought he was closer to 13, but we did properly measure him. And for a male, that's a pretty good size. Now, reticulated pythons, if you're looking at the big females mainland, they can get up to 20 feet long. Somewhere around 13 to 20 feet, males generally are gonna be smaller than females. And of course, the dwarf varieties and super dwarf varieties, depending, because if you get a pure locality, Kalatoa or whatever, these animals are gonna get maybe 6 feet for males. They can get a bigger, of course, but they might top out as small as 6 feet. So it just really depends. Never count on getting a 6 foot snake when in actuality, these super dwarf varieties could get 12 feet plus. But reticulated pythons are a heck of a lot slimmer if they're in good health than a Burmese python. A reticulated python is gonna be a semi-arboreal animal, and the Burmese pythons aren't gonna spend as much time in the trees or on perches as they age and become adults. So these are gonna be heavier bodied animals, the Burmese pythons, and they're only gonna top out around 16 feet if you get a really big one. I mean, 18 footers have been found, and the dwarfs are gonna be between 6 and 8 feet, sometimes maybe 10 feet, something like that. But they're way more rare. There are more super dwarfs available for retics than there are dwarf Burmese pythons by a lot. And because the retics are gonna be a little bit thinner bodied, I'm actually gonna give this one to reticulated pythons. So 1-0 for the retics. Category number 2 is enclosures. Now, the enclosures are gonna be very similar because these are very similar snakes from a similar area of the world, sometimes the same area of the world, and they have very similar requirements. So these snakes are gonna have similar cage requirements. So what did I say before? The difference is these guys, the Burmese pythons, aren't going to be as arboreal. They're not going to be considered semi-arboreal, a lot would say, where reticulated pythons are, which means that the retics, in my opinion, and this whole list is based on my opinion, there's no science to say who wins, this is what I think. Well, I think that the Burmese pythons are going to need less height, although you can give it to them, of course, as you can see Kratos is climbing here, but retics are going to climb full-on trees and get high in perches, so the retics are going to need more height than the Burmese pythons, and therefore you're gonna need a bigger enclosure, and that's gonna create other problems like heating and humidity and things like that. Generally, the bigger the enclosure, the more resources it needs to be at the appropriate standards for that animal, and therefore I'm gonna give this one to the Burmese python. We're at 1-1. Next, heat, humidity, and lighting. So basically, caging parameters. Now this is gonna be very similar. I don't know that I can give a winner here because they're from the same areas of the world. Now, of course, when I was in Bali, Indonesia, which both occur, okay? So there are reticulated pythons and there are Burmese pythons on that island of Bali, Indonesia. We found the reticulated pythons, but we did not find the Burmese pythons. And that's because the Burmese pythons were on the other side of the island where it was much drier. So there are going to be localities where, say, the retic is gonna need a little bit wetter, more humid environment than the Burmese pythons, even if they're from the same place. You can't go on the mic stand. So for that reason, I think that they're similar enough where it's the same island, and Bali isn't very big, by the way. With all that said, discussing differences, they're basically the same. I mean, not the exact same, but we're talking low end, high 70s, all the way up to high 80s on the warm end, basking spot around 93, something like that. So of course there is going to be variation, but at the end of the day, they're so similar with lighting, humidity, and the heating, it's going to be a tie. So, two apiece. You know what? No, I changed my mind because we're talking about captivity here, and you're going to need more heat and more humidity for a taller enclosure. So therefore, we're going to give it to Burmese pythons because it's going to be easier to give them that heat and humidity than it is the retics, simply because of the small enclosure. So really, it's 2-1 for Burmese pythons. Category number 4. Diets. Now, these animals are similar sizes, and we're going to say, you know, we're comparing mainland retics to mainland berms and super dwarfs to super dwarfs, things like that, right? Or super dwarfs to dwarfs. There are no technical super dwarf Burmese pythons. Either way, if you want more information about super dwarfs, go to Reach Out Reptiles page. I'm not an expert. If you want, I will do a care guide on super dwarfs eventually, and I can do a care guide on berms. I've had these guys for long enough now, I think. Okay, but the diet. So both of these animals are carnivores. Both of them in captivity are mostly gonna eat things like rodents. Now in the wild, retics will eat things like antelopes. Sometimes you'll get super dwarf or dwarf varieties that are gonna hang out in caves like we saw in Bali, and they're gonna snatch bats out of the air. Berms can do the same thing. They're gonna eat a whole bunch of different things, but in captivity, you're gonna feed them rabbits, pigs, things like that when they get big enough, and then rats as they are smaller. So with that said, it's so similar, how could I give a point to each? Well, the feeding response is the difference, because Burmese pythons will always eat. I've never had issues with getting Burmese pythons to eat. They always eat if the humidity and the temperature are correct. Retics will always eat too if they're healthy. So what's the difference? Reticulated pythons think everything is food all the time for no reason. Burmese pythons aren't quite as hungry in my experience. I feel much more comfortable going into a Burmese python cage than a reticulated python cage. And for that reason, in my opinion, I prefer a more laid back feeding response if they're gonna eat anyway, because it feels less dangerous to deal with that animal. So with that said, they're both gonna eat, just one's gonna be less dangerous to feed than the other. And therefore, I'm gonna give this one to Burmese pythons. So we're at 3-1 after 4 categories. Category number 5, we're talking about behavior. Now, both of these animals are curious and gonna be moving. But in my experience, reticulated pythons are more agile, they're smaller bodied. Where are you going? Oh, he's going back home. And Burmese pythons are much more predictable in my experience. Again, I'm not an expert. I've only had these animals, retics, for like a few months now, and Burmese pythons I've had for maybe 3 years. So he literally just put himself back into his house. Like, he crawled out of my arms and went right back into his enclosure. In my experience, reticulated pythons don't do that. Retics are more flighty and jumpy, and they move quicker and they change direction quicker, and Burmese pythons, in my experience, do not do that. So I think Burmese pythons, for me, are better. But if you are someone who wants a more active snake, who wants to feel on edge when you're handling, not to say that reticulated pythons are always gonna get you or you need to feel on edge, it just depends on your personality. I've had this conversation with Garrett Hartle at Reach Out Reptiles. That's why he likes reticulated pythons, because they're smarter, they act smarter, they move differently. But for me, I'm more laid back. I want a laid back snake that's not gonna, I'm not gonna have to worry about it. I'm pretty calm with him. I treat him the same way I would treat Pikachu, the ball python. But with reticulated pythons, even when you watch this B-roll of me handling my super dwarf Jasmine, 75% super dwarf, I'm a little bit more on edge. And that might just be the comfortability thing, but I definitely have to still give this one to the Burmese pythons. They are running away with it. We're talking about 4-1 for berms. But let's get on to the last category and see if we can kind of get a little bit closer. And that is price, availability, and morphs. Here's the big difference. When it comes to morphs, there are a lot for each in the mainland varieties. However, super dwarf reticulated pythons have a much bigger market, or at least more people working with them, than Burmese pythons of the dwarf variety. So when it comes to mainland versus mainland, it's pretty much a tie. Maybe even reticulated pythons would still have the upper hand in my opinion, because you have a lot more people working with those animals, or at least different genes of those animals. Now, when we're talking about the scaled down version, which are the better pets, super dwarf reticulated pythons are the clear winner. There are way more morphs, way more availability. The price, I mean, there's not really a crazy price for dwarf Burmese pythons because there's not a lot of genetics mixed in with them yet. So for that reason, they're kind of lower on the price scale. It's a clear winner. The price makes more sense and there's more range. There's way more morphs for the retics. And although the availability might be basically the same, I just feel like there's more people that I would know of. If you said to me, hey, name 5 Burmese python breeders and name 5 reticulated python breeders, I would name the 5 reticulated python breeders in 2 seconds and I'd have to think about the berms. So, and there's more variety for retics too. So it's 4-2, that's how we're gonna round this out. I want you to tell me, what do you think the best is? Is it a berm or is it a retic? Let me know in the comment section below. I'd really, really appreciate it. As always, hit the like and subscribe button if you wanna see more of this. And a special thanks to the Patreon supporters. There are new tiers where you get one-on-one time with me, a Zoom call, whatever you wanna do, whatever you wanna talk about, private tours of the room, things like that. For as little as $1 a month, you get all that and more and discounts on merch. And that's it. Because I do videos twice a week, Mondays and Thursdays. That means I'll see you in the next one.